Hi everyone, welcome back. Hope you had a good night's rest. Today is a new day at HeapCon. I won't take long, I would just like to put out some service information. Make sure you visit our sponsors at the first floor. Make sure you play the wonderful games they have. Make sure you play our wonderful game that is Don't Talk to Strangers. And that's basically it. I won't take up any of Scott's time. It's my pleasure to announce our lovely speaker, Scott, who's going to take it a bit old school and new school with his talk. Say okay. Warm welcome to Scott.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Good morning. A little bit of drinking last night. Great. All right, so I want to talk a little bit about version control. How many of you use version control? I'm just kidding. Everybody uses version control. And that's why I find it actually very interesting. But I've been hanging out with you guys for a couple of days now, and I know that most of you are probably too young to have used anything other than Git. Raise your hands if you've used anything other than Git. Oh, not too bad, not too bad. Okay, then never mind. This talk is stupid. I'll leave now. So, my name is Scott Chacon. I was one of the co-founders of GitHub. Most of you have probably at least heard of GitHub. Right now, I'm working on a new version control tool called GitButler. And in doing that, what's interesting is to look at why we're using version control, what we use version control for. I think it's actually a really valuable exercise, no matter what you're doing, no matter what product you're working on, to try to think about sort of first principles of what it is that you're trying to solve, and to look back at the history of how it came to be. Because a lot of times what we do is, with whatever that we're working on, is we kind of have assumptions based on what we've always used. So it can be anything, whatever product you're working on, whatever industry you're in. I think it's very common to not question what came before, right? And just kind of have it as, this is the state of the world, and those are my assumptions, and I'm going to build based off of that, rather than going back and trying to question what came before, why are we building off of whatever we're building off of. So I'm going to do this for version control as an example. I think you can do this with just about anything. But also, because we're all using version control, and it is really a major part of all of our software development workflows, no matter what you do, we all work in different languages, we all work on different types of products. But I think all of us write code, and thus all of us use version control. So what are we accepting as our version control tools of what we're using them for? And is that the best tool? Is that the best way of doing something? So again, I think you can do this with anything you're working on. I'm going to do it for version control because I find it very interesting. So right now, I think everybody uses Git. I've been doing talks now for probably 15 years since I started at GitHub. And when I was first on stages like this, most of my job was to try to convince all of you guys to use Git, right? Nobody was using Git. Everybody was on Subversion or Perforce or some other version control system. And there were all these debates online about what the next generation of version control should be. Should it be Git? Should it be Mercurial or Darks or Bazaar or whatever? I don't know if anybody has used any of those systems, but there's pluses and minuses to all of them. And we've all kind of landed on Git. And the reason why, I think, to some degree, is GitHub, right? Like everybody has kind of landed on either GitHub or GitLab or something very, very similar, right? Where they're doing kind of the same things. But I think Mercurial could have won that if there was a GitHub for Mercurial that was really dominant at the time. But since it's sort of conglomerated all of the workflows that we're all using, like it used to be that we would do open source sort of with Subversion or you know, on SourceForge or something like that, and then we would have our private things that we would do at work that would be a completely different system and a completely different workflow. And tools like GitHub and GitLab and these sort of hosting systems that we're using, strangely, have made everybody use distributed version control systems in a centralized manner, right? But like we're not actually using most of the distributed sort of strengths of these because we're all using sort of a centralized system. So what I want to do is walk through and do a quick history of the history of version control. Like talk about how did version control come to be and start questioning, is this really what we want in our workflows today? I'd like you to question the tools that you are using every day and be easily frustrated by what you have and try to ask for more, right? Because I feel like there's a lot of complacency around what we're doing. So as an example, I want you to do a mental exercise of what if there were no tools? What if you didn't have a version control tool? Has anybody ever worked professionally in a company that did not use version control? A handful of people. So I've done this as well. It's fun, right? It's not fun. It's not fun at all. What I did was, and you know, if you can imagine this, I would FTP files directly onto the production server, or if it wasn't working and I was trying to debug it, sometimes I'd just SSH directly to the production server and start editing PHP code and then seeing if it's working properly and say, okay, that's great. Everybody, please copy this down to yours. That was an actual, I don't know if I want to throw out a company name. Let's say it's a helicopter company that rhymes with Dell. I was there. They were not using version control for major sort of work that they were doing on helicopters, and I was like, maybe I'm never getting on a helicopter again. But if you're not using version control tools, you know, what would you do? You would sort of recursively copy a directory if you wanted to sort of make copies of something and remember where you were, right? Like you needed sort of to remember versions of things, and you would need to take those files and put them somewhere else, so you'd have to use FTP or you'd have to use some transfer protocol. And most of the time, we're not doing any of that anymore because Git handles all of that for us. But what I want to look at is a couple of the tools that came before. Raise your hand if you ever used RCS. Anybody that old? Oh, I'm just kidding. You don't even look. How did you use RCS? Anyways, I used RCS when I was in college because it was on sort of the systems that we were using. And it was the first version control tool that I used. I'm not quite that old. RCS was invented in the 80s. There we go. Oh, that's the 80s, if anybody remembers the 80s. This is when RCS was originally written. And what did it look like? So you would check in a file, and it would say, OK, now this file is sort of in version control. And then you'd have to sort of check it back out again. And then you could run things. So this is similar to sort of committing that you would do with Git today, right? And this might actually look relatively familiar, right? Like if you're using Git on the command line, this is 1980, right? Like this is 40 years ago. This is what the tools look like. And the tools that we're working with on the command line today are not massively different than this. You could run a log, right? It would sort of show you your logs. And it was all done locally, so there was no central server. It was just, I'm working with files, I want to remember what versions of these files were, so I have this nice little tool to kind of help me keep versions of files and branch and merge and things like that. So this is what version control looked like. You'd have branches, you had locks, you would lock a file. And so an interesting thing about this system is that it was all local, so you wouldn't really have merge conflicts with other people. You'd have to, you know, get other versions of files if you wanted to collaborate some other way, and then you could sort of merge them locally. But it wasn't really built into the system to be distributed. One kind of cool thing that it would do, I don't know if anybody remembers this, but it would do keyword substitution. So if you put this in your source file, when you check the source file out, it would replace all of this data with this in your file. And then when you check it back in, it would check back in this thing right here. And you can do this in Git. I don't know if anybody has ever tried to do something like this. Git has this thing called smudge and clean filters. And so you can say, process a file when you check it out, and then do some other process when you check it back in. So you can actually do this type of thing. But this was built into RCS. I actually found this kind of cool. And then after that, we had CVS or Subversion. Most of you have probably, or a lot of you have probably used CVS or Subversion. This is in the 90s now. And to try to remember what software development was like in the 90s, I had a hard time remembering this. But this is essentially when I graduated from high school, when I started working professionally. I found this on some website. You know, there were 100,000 websites, right? Like the internet was not really that big of a thing. That wasn't really what people were. It was just exploding at the time. But we had servers, right? And so we could do centralized version control systems now. And so now we move from a system where you're having all of your versions locally and you're checking in stuff and you know, you have version 1, version 2, version 3 of some file, and that was file-based. And we went to having a version control server, right? And so you would be able to commit, and a commit went straight to the server. And the interesting thing about this is that this was a merge before commit operation. You had to merge stuff before you could commit it. Now with Git, you will commit something and then you'll merge it after the fact when you want to push it to the server. But that changes sort of the way that you're collaborating. But this is what it was sort of in the 90s. And open source in the 90s was like this. Has anybody ever used Track or something like that? Right? Like, I don't know if you remember, before GitHub, open source contributions were horrible. it was really, really difficult to contribute to open source things, because you go to something like Redmine or Track, and you would upload a patch file that you would generate for whatever change you wanted to make, and then you would upload the patch file and maybe have a conversation about it, and then somebody would have to take that patch file and apply it to their you know, open source product or something like that locally. But there were no branches, there was no sort of GitHub forks, like all of that really changed the way that, that people collaborated. But I think a lot of people kind of forget how difficult open source was, right? And this is why it was so different to do open source versus doing private stuff, versus doing sort of corporate work, right? In corporate work, everybody has write access to the server, and so all of the workflows were a little bit different. And then in sort of early 2000s, we had this third generation of version control tools. So we had Git, we had Bazaar, we had Mercurial, we had Arch. There were all of these distributed version control systems. And the reason why I think that this wave came about was the advent of a type of technology, which was, so this is the 2000s. In 1994, right, when sort of Subversion and CVS were here, this was a thing from friends, right? We're talking about 12 megabytes of RAM and a 500 megabyte hard drive. This is the highest, the most awesome laptop that had ever been. It was super expensive, right? And about 10 years later, we have all of that on a small device, right? And so we have a lot more processing power. We have a lot more disk, I think, very importantly. And so version control systems came out that were distributed, where you could store the entire history. You would just clone. It wouldn't be a checkout of the last version. You would clone the entire database locally because, you know, networking is fast and storage is cheap. And so then we went into something like this, where everybody has the whole database locally, and you can push and pull to any of the nodes, and all of the nodes are kind of equivalent. And so all of these systems, Mercurial and Bazaar and Arch and Darks, they were all kind of doing this thing where you were doing everything locally, everything was distributed. And that gave rise to sites like GitHub and Bitbucket and you know, all of these sort of hosting options that were a little bit nicer, and started to merge the workflows of open source and corporate stuff. So now when you're working in a sort of corporate environment, you can use something like Git or GitHub or, you know, whatever else was out there, the same way in your company that you would use for open source. And I think that was actually a huge boom in open source, right? Because it was so much easier to contribute to open source. And so now, actually, if you think about programming, right, in 10, 20 years ago, if you wanted to start a project, you would not be really relying on open source as much, because there wasn't that much open source out. It wasn't, not as many companies were involved in doing open source work. And so everybody would be reinventing the wheel all the time. Nowadays, if you start a new project, you start with a framework. The first 10 lines of code that you're writing, you put some dependencies into NPM or into your gem file or something like that, and you're importing tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of lines of code that you don't have to write anymore, right? And you can start from that point. And so it's really changed kind of how development works. But our version control tools are relatively similar, right? If we're trying to figure out what's the change that was introduced by something, we're running a diff, we're getting a unified diff, it's not massively different than it was 40 years ago. This is basically the exact same tools that we're working with. And I find this interesting that this really hasn't changed very much. And the question is, has it not changed very much because this is the most perfect way of doing version control, of collaborating with people, of seeing changes, of merging work, or is it because it's the way that it's always been and it's kind of difficult to imagine, you know, what would be a better way? How do you want to work? Again, like the log, you know, if you're running a log or something, it's not that much different than it was 40 years ago. So I guess the question is, we haven't had, like I remember in sort of the early 2000s, we were having all of these fights over, is it Git, is it Darks, is it Mercurial, what is the right way to do things, you know, what's going to win in the end? And there's none of that today, right? There's no new version control tool that people are thinking about using. There's no innovation in this space. And I guess the question is it because all of our tools are completely perfect and we have no problems with anything that version control does, or is it just because we're complacent in this is fine, this is good enough, these are not the problems that I really want to worry about or care about? And so these are the generations, right? The first generation, there was no networking and concurrency was done on locks, so you would lock a file so that somebody else couldn't edit it, which was a huge pain in the ass. If anybody's ever used Perforce or something and somebody locks a file and then goes away on vacation and then everybody's like, well, I guess we're done working on that file. There's no getting that back now. But if you lock files, you don't have merge conflicts, right? And so I think what everybody deals with on a probably weekly basis is merge conflict problems with people because we're committing before we're merging, right? And we don't have some centralized way to lock files or to even tell people that we're working on these files unless you're pinging them in Slack or something, right? And so I think this difference between merge before commit and commit before merge, we've given up some strengths in order to get other strengths, but we still have some weaknesses in the system, and you encounter that every day when you're doing merge conflict resolutions. So the question is, what's next? And what I want to do is look at what version control tools are used for and ask yourself, am I happy with this? And what I want to do, and the way that I want to talk about this, I think it's actually kind of valuable, is to look at a completely different set of tools, a different industry, and how they solve the same problems that we solve with Git. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to compare, just as a simple example, Google Docs and Git. Because Google Docs, if you think about it, if you're writing a document, like if you're doing source code, you know, if you're writing source code, that's what you're doing, is you're writing a document, you're editing a document, you're making new versions of a document, you're trying to do something with a file. And Google Docs does exactly the same thing, just for a different reason, right? You're writing prose, or you're writing an email, or a letter, or you know, corporate communication, or whatever it is that you're, a book, right? Whatever it is you're trying to write. But Google Docs has version control tools as well. They're just massively different than source code version control tools. So what is the difference? Is there anything that we can learn from something that tries to solve the same problems in a massively different way and look at, would it be nice for us to have that in what we're doing with source code? So I'm going to make them fight it out. We're going to go through each step of what kind of version control tools do, and we're going to make them fight. Now, I wanted to come up with a way of showing how to make them fight, and so I found this image of these little arms that I found very funny. But it turns out I got this image from a product you can buy where you put these little arms on chickens. So if you own a chicken, you can have them have little fighting arms and walk around. This is not anything to do with my talk. I just really wanted to let you know, if you have chickens, please buy, that's $13, please buy this and then send me a picture of your chickens walking around with their little arms, because I find it completely hilarious and I'm sad I don't have a chicken to try this out on. Anyways, let's make them fight. So what are the things that version control does? One is save versions, right? This is kind of a fundamental thing. You run git commit, you're saving a version of the code that you're working on. But Google Docs does this as well, right? So this is how Git does it. You actually have to go and manually make a commit. Like, you have to go to the command line, or you have to go to your GUI tool, or whatever you're using to run git commands. And this was true for all version control tools that we've had for the last 40, 50 years. But Google Docs doesn't do this. You don't go to Google Docs and say, I want to save a version of this file, right? Like, Google Docs commit, like, and give it a message of some sort. It just does it automatically. Like, as you're editing the file, it's seeing, hey, you're making changes to the file. I'm going to record this for you. You can go back in time at any time. Be very easy to do. Why do our version control tools not do this? Like, wouldn't that be kind of nice to not have to? How many times have you lost work in Git because you didn't commit? Or have you committed like a work in progress commit or something so you know you don't lose it in the future, right? That's an unnecessary thing. We have lots of disk space. We have more disk space and more networking speed than we did 20 years ago when Git was invented. Like, why is this not something that we have in our version control tools, where it's just recording everything all of the time? It's kind of stupid to make work in progress commits or to lose work you've ever had on disk. There's no reason for that. One thing, so I'm going to give this actually to Google Docs. I think Google Docs has a better way of saving versions of files than Git does. Actually, and the problem, I think, with git commit is that it's logically used for three very different things, right? It's used to save work. It's used to say, hey, here's a thing I want to remember, so I'm going to save it. And you do work in progress commits, like, just how many, like, run git log and see how many of your git commit messages are valuable git commit messages, and how many of them are like, oh, I forgot about this thing, right? Like, it's kind of, you're just saying, hey, I want to remember this version. It's also used to transfer work, right? So if you want to share your work in progress with somebody, you have to commit, and in order to push it over the network, right? Or in order to push it to GitHub, or order to push it into the internet somewhere, so that you have a link that you can share to somebody. So it's used to save work. It's used to share work, and then it's used to document work, right? That's kind of the point of the commit message, is when you run a blame, you see what it is. But it's kind of overloaded. It does three completely orthogonal things with one command. And so that's why I think we abuse it a lot. But we don't question why is there one thing that does these three completely separate types of things. The other thing that version control tools help you do is experiment. So when you... this is a thing that's very difficult if you don't have version control tools to sort of experiment with stuff. But Git does this with branches, right? So you create a new branch and you can do some work, and it's not modifying the main thing. You can kind of do it in a safe space, and then you can merge it if it's great. You can, you know, work on it if it's not. You can do reintegration merges from the main line to keep it up to date if you want to. It's very good about experimenting and being on lots of different branches simultaneously. Google is not good at this, right? It's actually very, very bad at this type of thing. And so for this one, I'm going to give it to Git is actually a little bit better on this, I think. It'd be nice, actually, if Google Docs had some sort of branching mechanism, right? Or comparison, like red lines are not really that great for collaborating with people. For collaboration, I think Git is very complicated to collaborate with, right? You have to do commits, you have to push them to a server, you have to have everybody else kind of fetch them down. It doesn't do this automatically. Like, you can't, if you're working, you don't see what is everybody else working on in my network. It's actually relatively difficult to do that. It's doable. Obviously, you can fetch and get all the heads and look at, okay, what are branches that other people in my company have worked on, and what are the differences that they're introducing and stuff. But those are all manual processes, and no tool, even GitHub, doesn't really make this very easy. Google Docs has a completely different way of approaching this, which is everybody's editing the same thing simultaneously, right? So you see their cursors, you see them editing stuff. You can kind of do this with some plugins in source code, you know, in VS Code or something like that, but almost nobody really does that, because that's not really how programmers like to work. I would argue it's not really how people writing like to work either. But what this is nice for is that there's no merge conflicts ever, right? You can't branch, and so you can't have merge conflicts. And so you're not dealing with merge conflicts when you're writing in Google Docs. And so there's kind of a trade-off on that. So I'm going to give this a tie. There's actually interesting advantages to never having merge conflicts, but there's advantages to being able to work in sort of a safe space. The other thing that version control tools do is archaeology. And actually, it's interesting now, going through the list of all the things that version control tools do, all of these are kind of orthogonal on them on their own, right? Like, you don't technically need the same tool set to do all of these different things. The only thing they really have in common is a shared database, right? It's just the data of Git that allows you to do all this. You could have different tooling for all of these different things, but that's not really how we work for some reason. We're still all using Git for most of this stuff. But archaeology, what is the point of archaeology, right? It is to see what you've done, to answer questions about your code, to say who was working on this thing or who edited this so I have some context in order to make better decisions on how to edit it, you know, in the future. And so we have tools like Git log or Git blame or Git bisect. And there's pluses and minuses to all of these. Blame, does anybody use blame constantly? I use blame a lot, but blame is actually pretty bad because by default, and by default in most of the plugins and stuff that you have, it will blame white space change. So if you go through and you run a linter on a file, now you own that whole file, right? And you can tell Git to ignore that. If you do git blame dash w, it'll ignore white space changes. But if you copy a function and move it into another file, that's actually very difficult. Now you own that whole function because it looks like you added it in the file. You can also tell Git to ignore that. Does anybody know the command to do that in git blame? So it's dash capital C, and if you do dash capital C, that will do it in one commit within one file. If you do dash capital C two times, it will try to track it across files, and if you do dash capital C three times, it will try to track it across commits, right? And so it'll look very hard for that. It's relatively expensive to do, but nobody uses it, and so I find it kind of useless because you guys are all professional software developers, and almost nobody knows that you can actually do that, right? And so the question is, what are we really trying to answer with these commands, and are they really the best way of doing that? Even log is kind of a stupid, you know, command, right? Like, I think every Git GUI has this really pretty sort of, you know, graph that looks like a subway map of here's, you know, all of the different places that your code has gone. But I don't think anybody has a good question that answers, right? Like, it is very pretty, and it is data, and so it's kind of interesting. But, like, who cares? Like, Git log is good at answering one question by default, which is, what are the last 12 commits on this line, right, that are reachable? But nobody ever has that question. People have very useful questions, like, what's on this branch that's not on this branch, right? Or what were the commits by this person that touch this file? And you can make Git log do that, but it doesn't do that by default, and not everybody knows how. So Google Docs, on the other hand, you know, this is essentially all that it really does. It's actually, it can kind of tell you who edited what lines. It can kind of tell you, you know, how to go, what the history of it more or less looked like, but there's no real context around any of this. So for this one, I'm going to give it to Git, even though I just kind of shit on Git's tools for this for a while. I don't think it's perfect, but, you know, it's a little bit better. So I guess the question is, what do we want archaeology to look like? And then I think one of the last ones is moving bits. We use Git to move data around, right? So if you push to Heroku, if you push to, you know, I don't know, Code Control, or I don't know what people use these days, GitHub, whatever it is, if you are moving data, you're not SCPing files, you're not, you know, FTPing files, you're not doing any of that anymore. Most people are moving their code from one computer to another computer for CI or for deployment or for whatever, using Git as a transfer protocol. And that has nothing to do with version control, really, right? It's just, it exists so that we can do these sort of workflows, and then we've kind of overloaded it to say, well, I can move my trees of work with Git, so I might as well do it for every time that every possible instance that I want to move stuff. But it is very easy to do. Google technically has an API, but it's horrible. If anybody's ever tried to use Google APIs for anything, they're awful. So I'm going to give this one to Git as well. But just going through, here's all the things that version control tools do. Here's sort of the pluses and minuses of all these things. Is it a perfect system, right? For the workflows that we want, for the things that we're doing daily, it takes a lot of our time that we're not focusing on writing code. We're not focusing on making our systems better. We're focusing on, how do I figure something out with the tool set that I have? Or how do I save my work? Or how do I move my work with the tool set that I have? And I don't think it's perfect. I don't think it's what we really want. I think it's what we've kind of, you know, become accustomed to, and it's fine. So what is the next generation of version control tools look like? Like, I've already said, you know, I'm working on a version control tool. These are the questions that I'm asking. I don't really have the answers to this, but what I'm interested in is just to have you guys be frustrated with the tools that you have and try to imagine, what would a better system be? How do you want to work? How do you want to move bits? How do you want to do archaeology on your code? What tools do we have? What technology do we have now that we didn't have 15 years ago that we could take advantage of? Actually, one interesting thing, I think everybody really likes this idea of distributed version control tools, but all of us still depend on a central system, but we're not really taking advantage of anything we could take advantage of in having a central system, right? And so let's go through a couple of these things that I think a next generation version control tool that we'll be using in the future, you know, no matter what it is, right? I think something will come along that will displace Git to some degree, and I want to imagine kind of what that looks like. So one is obviously constant saving. You can kind of do this I don't know if you guys use VS Code. There's a timeline view. If you don't use this, you should totally use this because it kind of does this. If you know, do Command-P and open up timeline view, it will show you that it saves sort of a cache of every time you ever saved a file to disk. It also puts commits in here as well. Do I have a pointer? Well, I have a little pointer. But it puts commits in here, but it also just every time you save the file. So if you ever edit a file and then are like, oh man, I wanted a last version of that, but I didn't do a work in progress commit or whatever, it's not easy to get all of the files you did. But on a file-to-file basis, you can open up this timeline view. So this is actually very nice. But I think something like that should be in our general version control toolkit, right? Of we're not doing work in progress commits. We should just be saving our work all the time. Tracked code movement. This is actually something interesting from sort of how people used to argue about, like, darks or Git is, are we saving diffs or are we saving snapshots? So Git actually just saves a snapshot. It actually doesn't save a diff. When you run Git diff, it takes two snapshots of your trees and it does a diff on the fly. So it doesn't save. Every time you're seeing diff data, that's not data that Git has saved. That is data that Git is calculating in real time when you ask it to do that. But that means that it's actually relatively difficult to track code movement. Like I was saying before, if you take a function and you copy it into another file and you say, hey, where did this function come from or who owns this, Git has to do a lot of work to figure that out. It actually has to look at the trees. What? Did I say something? Was that God? It has to do a lot of work to track your code. But I think if we're saving changes all the time, it would be really nice to just say, hey, okay, let's look at what was edited, what was moved. We don't have to kind of figure it out from snapshots after the fact, and we can have really nice sort of code movement tracking. I think constant merging is another thing that we can be doing, right? Like I was saying, we all have a centralized version control system. There is a sort of database of what everybody on my team is working on. It'd be very nice for me to start typing and then have my version control tool say, hey, I see you typing in this file. I see that this other person is also on a branch that is actively being edited and wants to be merged at some point. You're going to have merge conflicts. Let's start working on them now rather than, I mean, how does this work now, right? You commit your branch, you get it all done. Somebody else commits their branch, they get it all done. The first person to hit that merge button is the winner, because they don't have to do anything. The second person to hit that merge button, even if it's 12 seconds later, is the loser. They have to do 100% of the integration work, right? And I think that's stupid. We're using distributed version control systems, but we have a central hub that everybody is using. Why is there no communication really between us until that is integrated upstream? It seems very stupid to me. And then the other thing that's interesting is now we have these fun LLM tools that we can play with. Like, there's lots of places in version control that we can use LLM tools, I think. One is merge conflicts. I don't know if anybody's ever tried this, but OpenAI is actually not horrible at helping you solve some merge conflicts, right? It'd be nice if some of this was integrated into our tool set. So if I had, this was an actual sort of diff conflict that I had, and I asked OpenAI, and it was like, here it is, and I could copy it and paste it in, right? This is actually exactly how I would have done this, and it's a little bit difficult for me to go through, because I, you know, Tailwind is awful, but to figure out, okay, here's the classes that were added, and then sort of merge these together. This is an actual merge conflict that it helped me solve. Again, I can do this. This is a relatively simple example, but it gives you an idea of what if there are models that were trained specifically on this, right? Like, I mean, GitHub has millions of merge conflicts, and you can recreate all of them, right? Like, if you go and you see a merge, and you can take the two parents, and you can do the merge in memory, you can see what the conflicts were, you can see what the resolution is, because they committed it, and there's millions of those on GitHub. Like, it'd be interesting to train something that's specifically good at doing this type of thing, rather than trying to do very complicated sort of semantic merge tooling. But, like, our merge tooling has not changed for 30 years, right? There's very, very little innovation in that space. And it's a huge pain for everybody in this room all the time. Documentation. Actually, it's a good question. Why are we even writing merge commit messages, right? We're writing commit messages to document stuff, but AI is actually relatively good at looking at diffs and documenting for us, right? Whether that's a conflict or whether that's a commit message, or like, why not just sort of do it after the fact? Why not write any sort of documentation on what we're doing and let AI figure it out after the fact and answer questions about the code that we had based on the conversations we were having in Slack, or, you know, the stuff that was happening around the code at the time, or the issues we were working on. There's lots of context that we miss out on with our version control tools, and it's on us to write all the messages and give context, and all of us are pretty bad at it, right? We're not writing like really good Linux, you know, mailing list style messages for every commit that we're doing that's perfect. We're writing crappy work in progress commit messages all the time. Answers about your code. AI can be very good at this type of thing as well. Like, and then the final thing is that I want to kind of end on is open source. I feel like open source is interesting to me because we all depend on it. Everybody in this room uses open source tools. Everybody in this room stands on the shoulders of hundreds of open source libraries in whatever project that you're working on. But probably very few people in this room have sent a pull request to an open source project in the last month, right? I mean, raise your hand if you've sent a pull request to an open source project in the last month. So it's a handful, but you're all using it, and none of you are contributing to it. I'm not really contributing to it for the most part, right? And, you know, why is that, right? And the answer is because we're horrible people. That's not the answer. The answer is because it's hard to do. There's a lot of overhead to this, right? It's difficult to maintain an open source library. It's difficult. It's a lot of work, and a lot of it's thankless. It's actually fascinating to me that we have as much open source as we do, because not very many of us are contributing to it. What I would really love to see is open source with way less friction, right? At a snippet level. What I'd love to see is being able to take some snippet that was written by, you know, Copilot or OpenAI or whatever, because I think most of us are using that to help us do little things here and there and not remember the syntax to stuff, or kind of using it as a replacement for documentation. But it'd be very nice. That it doesn't always work, right? It kind of gets you in the right direction. You can take it and say, you know what, I made it work, and I can verify that and send it back to sort of a central system and say, that is my contribution, right? This is in private code. I'm not going to open source the whole file or the whole library, but I got this little thing to work, right? I got this snippet to work. Let's share that with the community. I like open source to be much more focused and much smaller, right? That all of us are contributing to it, you know, millions of times a day across sort of the developer world, right? It'd be very nice for us all to be sharing much smaller things that are helpful in much smaller contexts and have a larger database of contributors. And yeah, so that's what I want to leave you on. I want to leave you on, I don't know what the next system of version control is, but I hope that I've kind of made you a little bit upset that your tooling for what you're doing is not better than it is, right? That hasn't changed almost at all in at least 15 years, right? There's almost nothing in Git that wasn't there 15 years ago. Like, we've tried to build sort of things around it. We've tried, GitHub kind of tries to cover up sort of, you know, the tool was really built for Linux kernel developers to create and send patches over mailing lists, right? And we've kind of worked in backwards into what the tooling that we have now. And I don't think that it's ideal, and I don't think it's how most of us really want to work. And so I kind of want your help, right? Send me a message, email me, tell me what would be cool. How do you want to work? What do you want your workflow to look like? Because I think there is another generation of version control tools that are going to be slightly more centralized. Like, take a lot of the advantages of what we have, but add on, there's so much more that we can do with the tools that we use every day. Thank you very much. Yeah, do I have time?
You have 2 minutes.
I have 2 minutes. Does anybody have any questions?
Hey. Thank you for a well done talk. I just want to ask you a question, because I'm working a lot with junior developers, and I know how embarrassed they are when they're working on stuff that doesn't really work yet. So they do a lot of back and forwards work, and I would just like to address that part. Like, what's the value in not committing instead of constant saving?
What's the value in not committing versus constant saving?
I mean, constant saving versus not committing, yeah.
I'm not sure that I understand the question, but I'll bullshit something. Let's see.
No, let me just clarify. I mean, I see the value in constant saving for, like, people who do know their work will work in the end, but reviewing someone's work, as someone who is reviewing someone's work, I would not like to see constant Git logs in the history of the file, for
example. Yeah, no, that's a good question. I don't think, I mean, my concept, how I would like to work is I'd like to work on something. I don't have to, like I'm saying, I want to separate the three things that I think we use Git commit for. What I'd really like to do is work on something, have it be synchronized somewhere. Let me be able to tell you, hey, this is a point at which I think it's generally okay. Have you look at it, give me some feedback. I can keep working on it without having to sort of interactively rebase the commits that I did. And I can sort of document as I go. And then I can, when I'm done and I'm pretty sure that it's done, then I hit sort of commit, or I break stuff up and I document them very well of here's what I was doing, like, in each of these things at the end of the process, right? I think the problem right now is that we have to commit in order to push, And so then we have to kind of document before we push. So like if we think about actually how Git was intended to be used on mailing lists, it's actually a very different workflow than how most of us use on GitHub. So on mailing lists, what you would do is you would do some work. You'd sort of make three commits, let's say. You'd send it to the mailing list. You'd get feedback on the whole thing. And then you'd take the feedback and you'd reincorporate it and you'd sort of rebase and you'd send another patch series of three commits that were updated and say, okay, this is V2 of my patch series. And you keep doing that, right? So you're not adding commits sort of to the end like most of us do on GitHub pull requests or something of like, okay, I'm addressing some issues. Because if you run blame, now you see, oh, Scott was addressing some issues, but you're not seeing what it'd be better to see the actual updated, sort of commit message. Because again, committing is partially about documenting. It's about documentation. And it'd be nice, I think, to wait until everything's done, to be able to get review before you commit, to be able to have people look at your work before you commit, to have everything saved in a way where it's not a commit every single time, right? Or try out merges without making merge artifacts. And just have your history be the history that you want, the documented sort of way that the code base evolved, rather than having to deal with all of the artifacts that Git has so that you can save work or so that you can share work with somebody, right? I think just being able to take those apart and having them be separate the way that they are separately useful to us is a better way of doing things. It's just not how we do it because that's not how the tool really works. If that answers your question. One more? Are we done?
You keep it short, maybe.
Oh sorry.
I'm kidding. Does anybody have one more question? Because we can take one more. No takers?
Okay.
Find him afterwards.
Right. Thank you very much.